Mr. President, over the weekend, the State Department, that's our State Department, imposed visa restrictions on several Ethiopian and Eritrean government officials. They claim these officials have not done enough to end the hostilities in the Tigray area. Now, the Tigray area is in the northern part of Ethiopia, and it's an area that's one of the very old parts of the of that continent. First, we need to be clear. Everyone, especially the Ethiopian government, wants nothing more than a peaceful resolution to the conflict in the Tigray. But this action puts the terrorist organization, the TPLF, that's a terrorist organization, on equal status with our Ethiopian government. Now, that's unacceptable, and it's wrong. It's outrageous that we'd have them in the same issue, as if they're somehow equals. Let me say something to be 100% clear, to make sure no one can misunderstand this, and that is that humanitarian atrocities are wrong and have no place in our world. I'm proud that Prime Minister Abiy of Ethiopia has clearly stated that any atrocities are not condoned by the government and those responsible will be held accountable. That's going to happen. To truly understand this issue and why putting the Ethiopian government on equal footing with the TPLF is so offensive and downright wrong, you need to understand how we got here. And indulge with me in just a little bit of history. Now, I know the changes Ethiopia has seen over the last decade. Since 2005, I have visited Ethiopia 19 different times, engaging and developing relationships with prime ministers, cabinet ministers, legislators, business people, aid workers, and everyone else in between. I say this to show that I know Ethiopia probably better than anyone else in this chamber, but more than that, I know its history. Ethiopia is the oldest independent country in all of Africa, but one that is newly democratic. And that comes with problems, and we understand that. The current controversy and why we are here today started back in the 1970s with a man named Mengistu. From 1974 to 1991, Mengistu was the leader of the Communist Derg. That's a communist party in Ethiopia. This was the controlling party at the time. It is a communist party. They ran Ethiopia. It was a terrible time for Ethiopia. That was during one of the worst famines that they ever had on that continent, or actually anywhere. It killed over 1 million people. That might be the most significant famine in the history in terms of deaths. Then in 1991, the communists were booted out. At the time that this took place, one person who was responsible for the getting rid of the Derg communists and the communist threat in Ethiopia was a guy named Meles. He was a member of the Tigrayan political party. Now, we got to know him quite well. He's the one who got communism out of that part of the world. He ended up as prime minister. This is really the election that a lot of people don't like, and they forget about the fact that he was the prime minister who actually got rid of the communists in Ethiopia. So he became a prime minister. He started to build democracy. He died in 2012. I got to know him quite well during his lifetime, and I saw the progress that he made and the advances that they made. He was then replaced by another prime minister whose name was Haile Mariam. Now, he became prime minister, and he continued to push for democracy. Haile Mariam worked diligently and improved things. Under his tenure, Ethiopia established the Independent Ethiopian Human Rights Committee that reported on violence and human rights and problems. It was tremendously successful. They didn't just establish it, they acted on it. They came out with a with a report and acted on it to hold perpetrators accountable and to make the improvements that were being made at that time. Our relationship wasn't just government to government, it was brother to brother. In February of 2017, Prime Minister Haile Mariam suggested that since the provinces were all fighting at one time, and at that time, there were 9 provinces in Ethiopia. Each province had a governor. We suggested on the phone with the members of the Senate here in Washington and the House prayer group in the House of Representatives that what we ought to do is follow the recommendation of Eisenhower. We're talking about former General Eisenhower. As President Eisenhower, was a great, great president of the United States. And this is right after World War II. He said, and this is a quote, I'm quoting Eisenhower now. He said, the problems of this world are so great that we will never resolve the problems until we learn to sit down and pray together. And so we decided, let's all get the governors, the prime minister, and the members of the House, and the members of the Senate, and the rest all together, and we will pray with them. We did this. In fact, we had 5 senators with me at that time, and we went over. The problem was only 2 of the governors showed up out of 9, so it didn't work. 8 months later, we had occasion to be back there, and we put together the same thing. But we talked to them to let them know. We talked to the governors at that time, and the 9 governors that were in Ethiopia. And so we got them and explaining what it was all about, and the governors who had been fighting with each other and had been fighting with Haile Mariam, they all prayed together, and we joined in prayer by 18 members of the United States House of Representatives. We were joined with them by phone, and the Prime Minister and all of us, members of the Senate and others who were there, we all rejoiced and embraced each other, and that's really significant. The 9 governors had never been together before. They didn't like each other. They'd never been in the same room before. Well, most of the people didn't live in cities, and that made this effort that much more difficult. The vast majority of people who live there are in rural communities, and that made this widespread change in development a longer and more difficult path. In Ethiopia, the tribal factions also played a great role. If you go from province to province, that used to be from tribe to tribe. And they historically have not gotten along until this time. So it made it more difficult because of the factions and all of that, but it worked. We unified them together, and that was unlike anything that has ever happened. One of the governors who was there at the time was named Dr. Abiy. You might remember that name because he's now the Prime Minister of Ethiopia. And I've often said that Dr. Abiy is arguably the most educated, the smartest guy that I've seen in that position in the entire continent of Africa. He was just a tremendous person. Well, we got them together and at a leader's breakfast, we put something together where he told the story of his journey and faith in Jesus. This is Dr. Abiy. We met a year later where we prayed and talked about how to unify the country in peace, not conflict. It is from these meetings that I know Abiy is committed to democracy and committed to the future of Ethiopia. He's showing that with his actions as well. Abiy was elected prime minister in 2018 after active and spirited protests against the existing ruling party, the Ethiopian People's Revolutionary Democratic Front, which had run the country for almost 30 years. Abiy was elected by a country looking for fresh leadership. He immediately took steps to create positive change. He promised unity and reconciliation, and against all odds, he delivered. He passed liberal democratic reforms. He freed political prisoners and journalists. Abiy even did what was once believed impossible. He negotiated a peace treaty with Eritrea after decades of long Cold War and was recognized with a Nobel Peace Prize for his work. Yeah, he was the recipient of a Nobel Peace Prize for all the wonderful work that he had done. That was in Africa. It was a leading operation. So how does all this play into the situation before us today? The Ethiopian People's Democratic Front, the previous ruling party, is dominated by people from Tigray, the area up north that we've talked about before, one of the regional provinces. When Abiy set up a new governing body and focused on governing for the whole of Ethiopia and not just a few politically powerful regions, the TPLF wasn't happy. That's the terrorist group. They felt like they were losing the outsized influence that they've held for decades and decades. They also weren't happy about the peace deal with Eritrea. The TPLF were ruling Ethiopia in the 1990s when the bitter Eritrea-Ethiopian conflict was going on. Decades later, they still feel aggrieved and didn't want peace. The result, they started acting out. In 2019, they started to refuse to participate in the new government and the new ruling party. They expressed their frustration in more overt and destabilizing ways. They held their own regional parliamentary elections in September during the height of the corona pandemic instead of agreeing with the other provinces and the prime minister that they should be postponed because of the pandemic. The militia affiliated with the TPLF, that's the terrorist group, that has been designated by the Ethiopian parliament as a terrorist group, attacked an Ethiopian army base near Mekelle on November the 4th and stole weapons there. Let me restate this plainly. A regional party, TPLF, attacked a government military base. The government rightfully responded, and the regional terrorist group is well equipped and has been fighting back and continuing the conflict for a long period of time now. And that's what's going on right now. That's the situation we find ourselves in. And that is why it is astounding to me that our government continues to treat this situation with both sides being equal when clearly they are not. One side is the democratically elected government, and the other side is a disgruntled faction that is reacting with violence because they are no longer in power. It's a terrorist group. And again, the Ethiopian government has been clear that they do not condone any of the reported atrocities, and they will hold anyone who commits atrocities accountable. We, the United States, need to continue to engage Ethiopia and try to understand how what we're seeing today is a product years in the making. It's not a simple matter of two aggrieved parties. It is prime Minister Abiy working to protect a unified, peaceful, stable Ethiopia. We should be talking to him about how we can help him restore peace, not slapping punitive sanctions on his government, an action that does nothing but demonstrate that we can't or won't appreciate the history and the regional differences that lead to this situation. And I want to close by speaking to Prime Minister Abiy and our friends in Ethiopia directly. Brother, I am with you. Those of us who understand the history, that what you are facing and what you are working to support, we are with you, Prime Minister Abiy. With that, I yield the floor.